I'll sing you the waters running through the town. Wildflowers and wattles when it settles down. The outback is impossible forever and it's free. No way can I find an end to what it means to me. To what it means to me.
The outback. You know, it's almost 90% of our country. But what is the outback? Well, to me, it's not just the red dust and the desert. It's all the isolated secret places right across our great country, from top to bottom, from blistering heat and humidity to wind and snow. But more than that, it's how it shapes the characters that live there. That's the journey I'd like to take you on, to see some of the special places and special people of the outback. Whilst the outback is magic, sometimes there's a special place right on your very own doorstep. This is Springbrook, overlooking the Nhumanbar Valley, southeast Queensland. And this is a special place.
Be with me at my mountain hideaway. At the end of the road that winds up to the moon. Above the ocean where the spangled drum goes to sleep to how's that song go? Mopoke, mopoke in the moon glow. Yeah, be with me at a clifftop shack of mine where you light a fire just so you know it's due. Watching the deer old earth roll over, it won't rain until October. Makes you high, completely sober. Look at me, I'm a witch tale. Don't you wish you could wind sail just above the steaming forest? Hope you don't mind the whippered crack of dawn. You don't want to miss the clouds go through your room.
No matter where I go in Australia, Springbrook is the place I love to come back to. It's like my base, my escape. It's just behind the Gold Coast, but it could be 1,000 miles away. It also has one of the most diverse flora and fauna habitats in the world.
Look at me, I'm a wedge-tail. Don't you wish you could wind sail just above.
This unique environment has been appreciated for decades. 60 years ago, Clarence Trist of the Queensland Forestry Department declared it should be preserved unspoiled for the enjoyment of our children and their children's children.
Wind sail just above the steaming forest.
What better place to bring new and old mates together? To say thanks in the best way I can, by putting on a feed and singing a few new songs with a real and magic backdrop.
Right on this very spot here is a beautiful natural hill with native hoop pines, and we found one was a bit rotten at the bottom. I didn't want to waste the timber, so we got 2.5 tonne of beautiful timber out of it. So I brought all this timber to my mate Mick Martin, and look what he made out of it. This is just one of the things, this beautiful big hoop pine table. Talented fella. I wanted to come and meet him. He's over here.
Now, ready, Mick?
Oh, he's well and truly ready, Don, yeah.
We're just showing him the table over there. Really turned out well, eh?
Yeah, it's not bad, mate.
Beautiful lovely hoop pint.
There's a lovely flat of hoop pint, mate, yeah.
It's not your only time, eh?
No, well, I learnt this cooking trade quite a while ago, actually. About 25 years ago, I went to a barbecue, a 21st birthday out there at Dural. It was a young rose grower called Joe Nadoy.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, and he had a few sheep of tin nailed up around some star pickets, and they cooked the sheep.
And you've improved on it?
Yeah, I have, yeah.
Well, show us how you invented the darn.
Oh, well, I got sick and tired of turning a crankhead on it, so...
It was an old bicycle.
Yeah, we got an old bicycle wheel here, and... an old electrical motor that just drives on the rubber on the bicycle wheel. You've got to have a bit of air in it, of course.
Yeah.
Use the normal sprocket on the bicycle wheel. Up here is a couple of crown wheels off the pedals on the bicycle.
And this one goes slower than that all the
other way. That's very, very limited, pretty much the same speed and around she goes. Runs off electricity. And then if you're out in the bush somewhere and you haven't got any power, this one comes in handy. And this is a windscreen wiper motor off a... a Sigma sedan, I think it is, yeah.
Yeah, hooking onto a battery.
Hooking up to a 12-volt battery, and you can do it in a scrub, mate. Yeah, no worries at all.
It's amazing, mate. Well, what do you call it? You got a patent on it?
Oh, I probably just mixed bit, mate.
Mixed bit?
Yeah, just mixed bit.
That's fantastic. Looks delicious, mate.
Yeah. Now
we should just give it one more spin, I reckon.
Oh, you might fall off, I think.
Just one more little spin.
Yeah, I'll give it a try. Camera, you don't fall off in there.
Just one little spin. Look at that.
All right?
Yeah, it's all ready to fall off and eat, I think. Beautiful, Mick.
This is what I like doing best.
Among the mob here are some of the folks I met during my latest trips into the outback that led to a whole batch of fresh songs from a new CD, which I'm going to sing today. We've even got Darcy Gallup from up near Cooktown. And I want some locals to be here as well. They've been a great help. Knowing I'm a bit rough and ready, they brought their own chairs. But we've provided the very latest in mod cons. There's nothing like heading up the road to where we've never been. Hear new birds, smell new smells, see things we've never seen. It's all rolled up and tied right down to the load, cannot shift. Cause Murphy's Law will never fail and things will come adrift. Down dusty roads, trusty friends, we're heading without a care to Frangipani Bay, way, way up there. There's more to Darcy Gallup than meets the eye. He's built bridges, gravel roads, he even used to fly. With a stand cost a kind of bash, brim over the nose.
Okay,
cigarette well, growing on his lip, our leader, I suppose. Now, Darcy, you're the fellow that inspired me to go to Cape York Peninsula in the first place. What do you reckon is so great about Cape York Peninsula?
I reckon it's one of the last of the wildernesses up in this part of the world. It's got unspoiled rainforest still, some.
Yeah.
Good fishing and not all that many people to pollute the place. Right. Hey.
Through the mozzie net I see, a star is still abright. The carpenter bird is hammering, the mozzies cannot bite. I smell the coffees on, runt's keen to catch a fish. A big juicy barramundi. We wish. This is Runt Price here, your brother-in-law. Runt, you're the big fisherman, but you don't eat fish. How come?
Oh, I can't get past the smell of them.
Down there on the Wenlock, Runt, we caught a couple of barramundi, but we had some 40-pound breaking strain traces, and they got snapped off several times. What do you reckon they were?
Yeah, I think they were big catfish. Yeah, it's hard to tell. End up getting the clothesline, remember?
That's right.
Yeah, we caught a couple on the clothesline.
Of course the girls are with us, they didn't have a choice. They're resigned to the fact that boys will be boys. And we wouldn't go without them and they wouldn't stay behind. Three good cooks with real good looks, very hard to find.
And that 6 foot taipan that come into our camp on the Ham River. That was a good experience.
That was scary. Between the two girls.
Yeah, they landed up in my lap, eh?
I think you might have put the snake in there, mate.
A little grass snake.
Down dusty roads, trusty friends were heading without a care. The Frangipani Bay, way, way out there.
Anyway, Darce, it's great that you came here because I wanted to repay you. I wanted to bring you to my special place and you showed me yours. I got some fantastic songs out of, well, some fantastic inspiration anyway. It's been really special to have made the effort to come here. Thanks a lot for coming up, fellas.
No worries, Johnny.
Thanks, John. Our pleasure.
Down dusty roads, trusty friends, we're heading without a care. The Frangipani Bay, way, way out there.
Thank you. It was great having Darcy Gallop with us on the trip up north. Up near Cowan in far north Queensland, he made sure I met two great characters, Dawn and Billy Jackson.
Just above the Archer, where the wild scrub cattle run, there's a little wisp of smoke in the air. From a corrugated station house, the Jacksons call their home, near the cattle yards down there in the gully. Granny Dawn will greet you just as sweet as apple pie, with a cake and king-size kettle on the boil. She drags the rusty gate with a welcome in her eye. She loves her little gun, you're in the gully. And they don't wear no shoes unless they saddle up a horse or take the shopping wagon into town. But it's a long way to Weeper, it can wait another week till the dust from the muster settles down. Ducking in the doorway, if you're nearly 6 foot tall, the beams of stringy bark are pretty low. And Billy hangs his hat on the longhorns on the wall, a cool siesta down there in the gully. And the old crown cooker smokes the kitchen sooty black, and wild pigs eat the mangoes in the yard. The granny finds it easy just to leave it as it is. She loves her little gun, you're in the gully. And ooh, she says it's getting cold, it's 25 degrees. But she's got special jam drops in a jar. And grandkids gather round, little hands around the cocoa. They love her little gun, you're in the gully. Just when you were thinking that the good old days were gone, there's Granny's little gun, you're in the gully.
Thank you. Beautiful firewheel. Natives of Springbrook. Now you're not going to meet people like Billy and Dawn Jackson if you're not pretty well prepared. I've got a couple of batteries in the ute, one for a fridge of course. Kitchen bench just hooks onto the side of the vehicle just like this. Got everything, including the kitchen sink. Voila. Wine rack, place the whole tomato sauce. We come around here, tailgate, just whack a bit of wood on the tailgate. You've got another table, of course, crowbar and shovel in case somebody else gets bogged. I never do. Very handy
dustproof shelving. Okay. Guitar, of course, locked securely away under the doors here. If I break a string, no problems. If I can't find my ukulele, no worries. Really good shelf here for lots of storage. If Mary Kay comes with me, I've got the queen size bed, of course. I prefer to sleep under the stars myself. But the really special thing to have is a bush shower. This one's pretty unique, it's also adjustable. Okay. Now, if you find a really good spot and you want to stay a couple of nights, I like to set up the little miniature stock camp. Really simple, just steel posts. But if you want to boil a billy in a hurry, whack in this T-bar, you got the adjustable billy, goes in and out over the fire, same with the frying pan. And the other alternative, when the fire is ready, just whack over the barbie. And there it is. And all this fits into a wheat bag. And that's all you need to get to the tip.
There's a warning in the travel book. The roads are rough and no Yankee chook. And the side tracks are just as crook. But you've come this far, so you take a look at a scary mountain with big black stones. Your axles crack and you rattle your bones. You find yourself stranded all alone. And you've got a bloody useless mobile phone. That's how you know you are. That's how you know you are. That's how you know you are on Cape York Peninsula. Very good. Now there's many strange tropical plants, big cathedrals built by ants. She finds a scorpion in her pants. Well, you've never seen a woman dance. Tossing her clothes all over the place. First the cottons, then the lace. Look at her go, wow, what a face. Come on, fellas. All about face. That's how you know you are. That's how you know you are. That's how you know you are on Cape York Peninsula. Well, a kookaburra tries to laugh as the tin pot trailer falls in half. Your darling wife has had enough. Using a bucket for a bath, but you're hardly even halfway there. It took you ages to prepare in desperation to make it square. You promise her overseas somewhere. That's how you know you are. That's how you know you are. That's how you know you are on Cape York Peninsula. Well, as cattlemen in bare feet, big spare ribs with not much meat. Even in June you feel the heat, so you give that crocodile a treat. Yeah, jump in the Jackie Creek, if that's the kind of thrill you seek. It's hardly a sport for the meek, they lost a retriever there last week. That's how you know you are, that's how you know you are, that's how you know you are on Cape York Peninsula. Well, as crystal waters, moonlit sands, no old farts and caravans. They threw away their travel plans. They got no further than north of Cairns. Now you're better off to go by ship, cruise to the top, enjoy the trip, have a celebratory nip, and kiss your husband on the tip. That's how you know you are. That's how you know you are. That's how you know you are on Cape York Peninsula. Again, that's how you know you are. That's how you know you are. That's how you know you are on Cape York Peninsula. Thank you.
You sing that beautifully.
Oh, it's really good to have a little brother. He's got the same mother as me. I give him heaps, he can take it. You know how little brothers can be. He follows me around like a shadow, piddles everywhere that I pee. It's really good to have a little brother. He's got the same mother as me. Yeah, it's really good to have a little brother. He copies everything that I do. And now that I got me a girlfriend, he wants to cuddle her too. But he can climb where I can't climb, so I send him up the apricot tree. Really good to have a little brother. He's got the same mother as me. Yeah, sneaky little shitty little brother, always nicking off with me bike. He has to stand up to reach the pedals. I can ride anything I like. Foot slips, squashes his knackers. I serve the little bugger right. Sneaky little shitty little brother, always nicking off with me bike. Yeah, it's really good to have a big brother. Thinks he's smarter than me. But I've got the only kookaburra egg from the holler in the big gum tree. He chases me down to the river, cause I thrash him at Monopoly. It's really good to have a big brother who thinks he's smarter than me. Yeah, and it's really good to have a big brother. I saw him kissing Mary Grant. I saw him put his hand in a dress. She must have had a greenback aunt. And he made sure it didn't boil her, cause I wasn't in a bra or a pants. Yeah, it's really good to have a big brother who's not scared of spiders or ants. Yeah, it's really good to have a little brother. He's got the same mother as me. I give him heaps, he can take it. You know how little brothers can be. He follows me around like a shadow. Fiddles everywhere that I pee. It's really good to have a little brother. He's got the same mother as me.
I reckon dairy farmers are amongst the real unsung heroes of the bush. They do this hard, repetitive work day in, day out, so the rest of us can put milk in our tea and butter on our toast. Down the road from my little place at Springbrook, they've been dairy farming for as long as anyone can remember. But nowadays, there aren't many cow cockies left making butter out of grass.
The whole school could smell it as he pulled up in his ute. When Dad came to my class, cow dung on his boot. He'd been up since 3:30, Mum had gone to town. You're gonna have to come now, son, the milking cow is down. So I drove the Fortune tractor, rope around ahead. Come on, old girl, get up, or tomorrow you'll be dead. You see, I was always learning, even when I wagged my class, like how to make a living making butter out of grass. Grass goes in one end and dung comes out the back. Milk comes out the udder and you squirt it in a vat. And dung makes the grass grow around and round it goes. Milk to make your tea, cow dung to warm your toes.
Peter Yawn, you're a dairy farmer in the beautiful Nhumbunbar Valley. How many generations?
I'd be the fourth generation, and my children are the fifth generation in the district.
Are they going to stick at it?
I don't know, John. It's pretty difficult in the industry at the moment.
Yeah.
We'll just have to wait and see.
And how many dairy farmers are in the Nhumbunbar now?
We're down to five.
And what do you reckon was there originally?
Oh, there would have been in excess of 50 at one stage, yeah. I guess.
Is it really true? You get up at 3:30 in the morning?
Just about. I get up about 3:45.
Sleep in a bit.
Oh, yeah.
You never come to the mache, I suppose you're too damn busy, mate.
Oh, no, it's not very much to get into your shows, but I don't see much point in going there and going to sleep at that time.
Christmas Day or Easter, it doesn't matter when. Milking every morning and afternoon again. Even at a bushfire, you gotta head back home. Sorry, mate, the cows can't do it on their own. Even on Dad's birthday, he turned the big 5-0. Full as a tick, he milked them, and he didn't even know.
Philip Thompson, you reckon dairy farmers work hard?
Yeah, they work hard. They get up early in the morning, but a lot of them got big families. They must sneak home for midday matinee. Some of them I've seen that plenty of kids, a milk check be less than the child endowment check.
Now I propose a toast, so would you raise the glass to folks that make a living making butter out of grass. Grass goes in one end and dung comes out the back. Milk comes out the other and just squirted in the bag. Dung makes the grass grow around, around it goes. Milk to make your tea, cow dung to warm your toes. Milk to make your tea, cow dung to warm your toes. We used to have a mighty big river. There's a poet we all call Banjo, wrote a legend about a ride, about a man on a horse. He was brave, of course, and part of our nation's pride. We used to learn the poem at school, I'm hoping the hell we still do. The man from Snowy River means a lot to me and you. But what about a mighty big river that used to flow wide and strong? Thought we were clever to dam all the water, but we all know today we were wrong. We used to have a mighty big river, we rode a little boat to get home. You know what I wish? I wish we'd left the Snowy River alone. But that's a romantic notion, a dreamer's luxury. Soon we'll be paying for rain, and they'll add on a GST. You can't have a river these days if they don't get a piece of the pie. But the Snowy River people are saying we can't let the Snowy die. Yeah, what about a mighty big river that used to flow wide and strong? Thought we were clever to dam all the water, but we all know today we were wrong. We used to have a mighty big river, we rode a little boat to get home. You know what I wish? I wish we'd left the Snowy River alone. Given up the fight, I've got a deep down feeling the Snowy River people are right. We ought to be ashamed, us humans have got a cheek to leave her high and dry, to dribble like a little creek. Yeah, what about a mighty big river that used to flow wide and strong? Thought we were clever to dam all the water, but we all know today we were wrong. We used to have a mighty big river, we rode a little boat to get home. You know what I wish? I wish we'd left the Snowy River alone. You know what I wish? I wish we'd left the Snowy River alone.
This is Will, who's my oldest brother, but he's actually younger than me.
I've had a harder life.
No, probably, yeah. Now, listen, Will's an absolute Ned Kelly fanatic, and he's inspired me over the years to think a lot more about Ned. Now, I read Peter Carey's latest book about Ned, and I was really intrigued by the story of how his mentor, Harry Power, taught him everything he knew about the bush. And Harry gave him his first pair of boots. And seeing Harry was a bushranger, they really were the devil's boots.
You know, I had to take it, Lord, the chance to be a man. Couldn't hide behind the wood heap like a rabbit. Didn't really want to fill the boots of the devil, but I pulled them on anyway. Didn't want to know how to be a bush ranger, run every ridge I could ride. Didn't need to learn, Lord, the thrill of the danger. That's it to be a Kelly anyway. You know I had to do it, Lord, on the son of my mother. And I've got her fire in my belly. And I've got good reason to stand and be counted. Was there really any other way?
And, Will, what initially got you interested in the Ned Kelly story?
Well, the first thing was, John, I saw the Mick Jagger movie years ago. And, yeah, I started to read more about Ned, and I became completely hooked on him. But it wasn't until I was hit by a train at Liver Crossing back in 81.
You got hurt pretty badly, eh? You broke a few bones.
Yeah, that's right. This leg is broken in three places. I dislocated this leg, and all my ribs are broken, broken collarbone.
You were in hospital a couple of months, weren't you?
Yeah, actually 3 months.
3 months.
Strange enough, the same time Ned was in hospital after the shootout at his last stand.
And what you were thinking about Ned all that time.
Yeah, that's right.
You reckon it was Ned's spirit that got you through the hospital, the injuries?
Yeah, I made an oath while I was in hospital, if I get out of this and can walk, I'll dedicate as much of my life I can to Ned, and that's why I had the full suit of armour made, and I was determined to be able to carry it around. When I got back on the hay farm, I had a pin put on my leg, and I said, I'm not going to walk around and not be able to work, so I started cutting hay. And I said, within, say, 4 months, I was cutting hay and driving a truck again.
So come on, you constables, teach me a lesson. Can't deflate the pride in my heart. Can't teach me to ride, I without a saddle, 'cause I am a Kelly anyway. I didn't want to know how to be a bush ranger, run every ridge I could ride. Didn't need to learn, Lord, the thrill of the danger. That's it to be a Kelly anyway.
And it was all made out of moldboards.
Yeah,
which we have here, single furrow plough.
Single furrow plough, all the farmers around the, and that, Ned's days, had all this sort of stuff. So what they did was they stole the moldboards, ploughs from farmers who were sympathisers for the Kellys. That's one way of getting payback. And when they were a little bit short, I think a lot of them were donated to the Kelly.
Some of the farmers that were actually on their side gave them their moldboards.
Oh, sure, yeah, that's right. Because otherwise they wouldn't have been able to get enough moldboards.
So it was quite a sacrifice for some of these farmers to give away what might have been their only plough.
Well, there are other sacrifices too. The fact is they're supporting Kelly and the blacksmiths, supporting the Kelly idea of being able to do this confrontation at Caesar Glen Rowan.
So here's the actual helmet that we've got made up, and it's got all the real dints, and it's got the hole.
Yeah, that's right.
Was that on the actual moldboard?
Yeah, it's a moldboard hole.
They made five of these, so this is a copy of Ned's own helmet.
Yeah, this one is, yeah.
Explain the dents in it.
Yeah, this one here is one of the earlier rounds when I hit him right between the eyes, and at that particular stage he'd lost his cap inside, so he automatically got two black eyes, you know. Quite a lot of bullets hit the helmet, and every time he got hit by a bullet, it nearly sort of knocked him over. The force is that great.
So he's pretty tough.
And don't forget too, Ned also lost probably about four pints of blood, because he'd been bleeding all night, and he still was able to take the force of that.
And not only was the armour effective, it scared the hell out of him.
Can't teach me no anger, I feel for the squatter. Been reading the greed in their eyes. Can't teach me to fight my way. With a Kelly anyway. Yeah, I didn't really want to fill the boots of the devil, but I pulled them on anyway.
People visit the outback for all kinds of reasons. For some, it's to gain strength and help rebuild their lives. Not long ago, we did the big trip on the legendary Indian Pacific, out across the Nullarbor from Perth to Sydney. It was fantastic. On the train was this lady called Hazel, and this is her story. Keep smiling, Hazel, you're a darling.
Buried in her bedclothes, her old man has gone. Buried in her bedclothes, she couldn't face the music. Buried in her bedclothes, she's coming out today. Going down the Great Southern Railway. Been with the same man for 60 of her life. Been right beside him, devoted wife. Been right beside him, whatever came along. Always been their own boss. Buried in her bedclothes, her old man has gone. Buried in her bedclothes, she couldn't face the music. Buried in her bedclothes, she's coming out today. Going down the Great Southern Railway. Through the blue mountains, across the western plain, through the blue saltbush, riding in a train. Major Mitchell Cockey's sitting on the track. The Indian Pacific is bringing her back. Started with a dairy, then they moved along. Bought a hotel, but things went wrong. Boarding house was okay, bought a taxi cab. Always been their own boss. Buried in her bedclothes, her old man has gone. Buried in her bedclothes, she couldn't face the music. Buried in her bedclothes, she's coming out today. Going down the Great Southern Railway. Through the blue mountains, across the western plain. Through the blue saltbush, riding in a train. Major Mitchell Cockey's sitting on the track. The Indian Pacific is ringing her back. The Indian Pacific is ringing her back.
I've also been inspired by the Snowy Mountains for this album, and got a couple of songs up there. I want to do one for you. I visited quite a few characters up there, and we had a beautiful steak at Brumby's, which at the time was owned by Stumpy Prendergast. And it was probably the best thing he did. He shouted me a beautiful big rump steak, and I've ended up writing a song about him. But it's about many other things, and it's called Around Jindabyne. I thought it was time, but I didn't need a reason to climb Kosciuszko before the snow season. To walk to the top of my country was pleasing. There's a place in my heart for the snowies, where Wally has a chuckle about cracking back. His mountain was stolen and taken off the track. Nobody asked him and they won't give it back. It's a yarn you will hear in the snowies, where gang gangs will chew the fresh buds on the vine. Where folks chew the fat, it's a pleasure to dine with Stumpy at Brumby's, good rump and red wine. Not much goes unnoticed around Jindabyne. The Bruce of all trades, the master of most, been clearing and shearing and sinking a post. The trapping wild dogs, well, he's not one to boast. It's his missus who does all the talking. And his lady's got trophies and buckles from riding, and pictures on walls of the life she takes pride in. Not backward in giving your ear a good hiding. No wonder he don't watch the telly. As a couple, they're
legends and straight down the line. And Stumpy will tell you they're good friends of mine. And if Stumpy approves, then your life will be fine. Not much goes unnoticed around in the line. And the pleasures of bushland increase when you're older. There's a wombat digs a hole that goes under a boulder. Look out for the wallaby with the rust on the shoulder, all part of the high country legend. And they reckon the robin has made quite a name. As a sign of the winter, its main claim to fame. It's just in the snow, it'll glow like a flame. It's another wild yarn from the snowy. Yeah, the bush has its legends much older than time. Like the scribbles on white gums are some kind of sign. I bet Stumpy can read them, so all will be fine. Not much goes unnoticed around in the line. Where gang gangs will chew the fresh buds on the vine. Where folks chew the fat, it's a pleasure to dine. With Stumpy at Brumby's, good rump and red wine. Not much goes unnoticed around you, divine. That's for the Snowies. Well, there's not much to say about this one. It's a love song, I guess. Mary Kay probably doesn't remember, but quite a few years ago, she said to me, gee, you know, maybe I should leave you so you can sing the blues. I was talking about singing the blues, you know, and I can't do it. She said, well, maybe I should leave you. I didn't think that was a very good idea. I can sing the blues, but you wouldn't really do it, would you, darling? I'd throw away the guitar and catch on to the booze, but you wouldn't really do it, would you, darling? 'Cause you are my foundation, my anchor, my home, knowing that you love me wherever I roam. You see, I wouldn't sing at all if you went away. Say you wouldn't really do it, would you, darling? But go ahead and try it, take the car and go. If there is some other reason, darling, turn off the sunshine, cancel the show. Say you wouldn't really do it, would you, darling? 'Cause you are my foundation, my anchor, my home, knowing that you love me wherever I roam. You see, I wouldn't sing at all if you went away. Say you wouldn't really do it, would you, darling? Sing it all if you went away. Say you wouldn't really do it, would you, darling? Say you wouldn't really do it, would you, darling? I guess, cool. You are my foundation. We've got a special guest. We've got Lionel here. That is the greatest whip cracker in the Numbabar Valley. Lionel Thompson. So, Lionel, come and show us your stuff, mate. You got the whip there with you? Perfect spot over here, I hope. It should echo fairly well. Not too close to me, though. Ooh. Give him a round of applause, folks. Lionel Thompson. He is better than his old man. I'm really drawing just as good a crowds in New Zealand these days. And it turns out there's dairy farmers over there too, and cattlemen and all the rest of it. And a lot of them would love to live in Australia, they admit it to me, you know. But, of course, they'd always be bloody All Black supporters. And even the fact that I support the rugby was, as far as they were concerned, was a plus because, you know, because a lot of Aussies don't, you know, they support Aussie rules and stuff like that. So they figure I'm okay because even if I do support the Wallabies. But I often sing a song called Diggers of the Anzac. And I think a lot of young Aussies forget that Anzac does stand for Australian and New Zealand Army Corps. And so I've used that song to great advantage, of course, over there. And they're very proud, of course, to be part of the Anzac legend. But I don't actually mention New Zealand in that song, so I feel a bit bad about it after I sang it over there. And I thought, I'll make up for it. And I've got this, it's sort of an oldie song, but then again, it's not. It's called The Kiwi and the Emu. There's a story, is it true? The Kiwi has a brother. The Aussies call him Emu. He runs around all Uluru. They've been mates, that wingless pair. The one's up here and one's down there. A pair of Anzacs stuck like glue. The Kiwi and the Emu. So don't be fooled if you see them fight when tempers fray on a summer's night. If you pick on one, you pick on two. The Kiwi and the Emu. Kiwi says he's very proud. He's from the land of the long white cloud. The emu brags of open plains, quiet where it seldom rains. They argue that their home is best. They'll fight it out at a rugby test. They're thick as thieves, I'm telling you. The Kiwi and the Emu. So don't be fooled if you see them fight when tempers fray on a summer's night. If you pick on one, you pick on two. The Kiwi and the Emu. No, don't be fooled if you see them fight when tempers fray on a summer's night. If you pick on one, you pick on two. The Kiwi and the Emu. They fought together many wars, side by side on foreign shores. Back away, no, not at all. Buried their mates to the bugle. Always wearing a digger's hat, never forgotten that is that. Feel like brothers, of course they do, the Kiwi and the Emu. So here's a warning, take it in. These two birds through thick and thin will stick together till the end. Cause a mate is a mate for dinkum. And don't be fooled if you see them fight when tempers fray on a summer's night. If you pick on one, you pick on two. The Kiwi and the Emu. Now don't be fooled if you see them fight when tempers fray on a summer's night. If you pick on one, you pick on two. The Kiwi and the Emu. Now don't be fooled if you see them fight when tempers fray on a summer's night. If you pick on one, you pick on two. I could spend my holidays on videos galore, or lie on the beach getting sorry and sore, or I could sail the ocean, see another foreign shore. Well, I took my little kelpie and I sailed another boat, and I saw the colour changes from Albany to Broome. A pair of white corellas singing out a tune. The wildflowers in bloom. And I saw the rusty Hammersleys from a dusty Whitnoon. And I saw the giant carries all. You couldn't paint the view. Amazing what a crosscut can do. I would have liked to have been there before. heard about the whales and cried. Bloody thousands died, but they're swimming back to sing. I bet you never heard a more beautiful thing. Through the Swan Valley, there's Banksias and warriors making a stand. Yeah, look out for black boys, like guardians protecting this dear old land. Spinifex and snappy gums, hazy green, blue, gray. You gotta go that way. There's nearly half Australia over there in WA, where I saw the colour changes from Albany to Broome. A pair of white corellas singing out a tune, or wildflowers in bloom. And I saw the rusty Hammersleys from a dusty Whitnoon. You could spend your holidays on videos, or lie on the beach getting sore, or you could sail the ocean. Why don't you take your best mate and sail another boy? Why don't you take your best mate and sail another boy? Hey!
Thanks, folks. Thank you.
Got a beak and feather than things, but the poor old fella ain't got no wing. Aren't you jealous of the wedge-tailed eagle? And well, the eagle's flying around and around to keep 2 feet firmly on the ground. I can't fly, but I'm telling you, I can run the pants if I can get ready. But I don't know. He can't fly, but I'm telling you, I can run the pants if I can get ready. You can't loop the loo like a cockatoo. Swerve and toss like an albatross. You silly galah, I'm better by far than a white cockatoo or a budgerigar. Squeak and squawk and try and talk. Why, me and them's like cheese and chalk. You can't fly, but I'm telling you, we can run the pants of a kangaroo. Well, a dingo came around one day. Hey there, emu, you wanna play? But the emu was too smart for him. Walked right up and kicked him in the shin. He can't fly, but I'm telling you, we can run the pants of a kangaroo. Well, the last time I saw old man emu, he was chasing a female he knew. As he shot past, I heard him say, she can't fly, but I'm telling you, she could run the arse of a kangaroo. But I don't know. She can't fly, but I'm telling you, she could run the Well, there is a moral to this ditty. Thrush can sing, but he ain't pretty. Duck can swim, but he can't sing. Nor can the eagle on the wing. Emu can't fly, but I'm telling you, he can run the pants of a kangaroo. they said it's true.
In 99, our family had a huge shock. We lost our middle brother, Robin. He was only 47, and he had this bit of a lump under his arm, and 6 months later, he was gone. And as Will remembers, he didn't want any of us feeling sorry for him. He had this wonderful houseboat and a house on the Murray River, and he used to go up and down it as much as he could. And I went with him one day and was inspired to write a song. Now, we were brought up in Salisbury Street in Quambatook in the Mallee in Victoria. So I've called the song Salisbury Street.
Now's not the time for wailing, for there's water in the river. We'll all lay down and cry when it's gone. I'll be a jackass and laugh at every sunrise. Celebrate the day when it's born. And we'll cruise one more time down the river while our hearts overflow with joy. And we'll reminisce our days down Salisbury Street. Salisbury Street, Salisbury Street. Yeah, we'll cruise one more time down the Murray. Don't wave the river guns goodbye. Just thank them for the shade and the stories. Tomorrow there'll be time to cry.
Remember, Will, Mum was mad on dressing us kids up.
Oh, that's right.
Five of us up, going to fancy dress competitions. We used to win quite a lot,
oh,
actually.
That's right. I was pretty good at it.
And she dressed Robin up one year as he was only about pint size, you know, and he dressed him up as a little red devil. The cape on and a hood, you know, a forked tail and the pitchfork. And he looked that good that my mate called him Pitchfork after that forever, you know. I think his mate Mick Morgan called him Pitchy, wasn't it?
Yeah, because he used to go around and stab everyone with it, didn't he?
Did he? But he was a little devil. He used to peel all the tyres off my little collectible micro models. I got really annoyed with him.
Yeah, that's right.
But he turned out a pretty good bloke, eh?
So untie the ropes, my darlings. This broken cloud today, and that lucky yawl will make those billows blush. Don't want to miss the sundown shining on the water, chasing sneaky shadows through the bush.
Yeah, I turned up at Moama one year, and here he is welding away. He was a good welder, Rob, wasn't he? Welding these great big floats. I thought, what the hell are you doing? He's making a houseboat. And it was huge. It was him and his brother-in-law at the time that built it. And it was a huge, huge houseboat. It was just fantastic. I couldn't believe he built it.
Yeah, that's right.
And the Murray River was really good to go up and down in, of course. He really enjoyed that. He had a lot of great orchard trees and grew a lot of vegetables.
Yeah,
loved being at home with his family, really, didn't he?
Yeah, on 25 acres around the Murray. Yeah, he had his own little plantation out the front, didn't he?
Yeah.
It was nice.
Yeah, he had a good setup.
So while he did live, he lived happily, if you know what I mean.
Yeah, he had a good life. Yeah. Loved being on the Murray.
Oh, that's right.
I miss the bugger.
It'll be a big loss, John, there's no doubt about that.
Miss it.
It's a shame.
Tomorrow there'll be
Thank you.